have spent most of my career working in healthcare settings, either with people with serious and chronic illnesses, and it's been the area that I've been most interested in. So I've either been working directly with people with illnesses and their families, or with training with medicine residents. And currently, right now, my practice is actually at Wasatch Internal Medicine and Family Practice, so I get the opportunity to work with healthcare providers in managing psychological needs of their patients. So for me, it's a perfect setting. Humor is always a good thing. I kind of like this cartoon in my practice. I prefer to treat the whole hog. Because I think, you know, our mental state and our psychological state is directly connected to what our bodies are doing and our physical health. And so we do need to deal with both of those things. So one of the things I like to think about is that people aren't sick in the same way. People are sick dependent upon a number of different variables. Some of it's family. I don't know how people were sick in your family. In my family, if you were sick, you got the television in your room, you got to have real Coke, and nobody paid attention to you. So you kind of got some cool stuff, but you also got ignored, so you didn't get quite as much attention. But I think every family has their style of how people are sick and how people respond to folks when they are sick. And there's actually some literature on chronic pain that suggests that people who have chronic pain problems, for probably lots of reasons, have family histories of people with chronic pain problems as well. So probably some of the ways they respond to that are determined by some of the patterns they've seen. Coping strategies, what are the things that we do to cope with the stressors in our lives? And the cognitive behavioral aspects are certainly a big part of that in terms of how is it we cope with things. Need for information. I saw a new client today who actually has post-polio syndrome. And I bet she's read everything on the internet. She didn't come in with her article for me, but she promised she'd bring it next time. Somebody prescribed a medication, and she called them back to check out a couple of the things that were in the information. So, and then there are other people who was like, just tell me what to do. I don't really want to know anything. Most of you probably need more information if you're here, right? Okay. And what we think about is locus of control. Do I think that I look to other people to control events, or do I look to myself? It makes a big difference in terms of how people manage chronic pain. And acceptance, which is another thing I'm going to talk about, is how we accept illness and how we work with it. Do we resist things, or do we go with what's real and what's present? And it's something I've been thinking a lot about with working with people with chronic pain and chronic illnesses, is that one of the ways that we get ourselves in trouble is by trying to work against the things that are going on in our lives. So I can't do this without talking a little bit about stress. And I don't want to spend a whole lot of time, but it is that kind of old fight or flight response. It's a really primitive biological response. It's our body gearing up to manage things in our environment that are threatening. So works really well for saber-toothed tigers, but it doesn't work real well for things that are stressor than most of our lives. I joke that it makes no difference if I beat up my computer, it still doesn't work. So if you think about that, it's a physiological response with your heart rate increasing, your blood pressure increasing, and you're getting all that adrenaline to move things. The conflict you're having with your spouse or at work or with your health are going to be things that are going to lead to you being more in that chronic fight or flight response, and there are negative impacts to that on your health. I'm usually pretty good with interactive things, so if anybody has a question, we can make them bring the mic out. It makes it a little onerous with tapes and recordings and whatever, but if you have a question, please feel free to ask. So when I think about stress, it's kind of like, is there too much or too little? There are actually some interesting studies that I've looked at. When there's no stress, people perform equally as poorly as if they have some too much stress. So it's a physiological response that allows us to meet life's demands. I always joke that if I had no stress, I'd probably be a large couch potato. Wouldn't have any energy or the impetus to do the things that we need to do. Paradoxically, it's necessary to survive, but also a biological threat to our well-being. The problem's not the stress, but how much, how often, and how we deal with it. So all of us need to have stress in our lives. And so the issues really are, do we have too much stress? Do we have too many things on our plate that we're trying to juggle and manage? Is it something that's occurring all the time? I think that's something in our modern culture. You've got stress at work, and then you go home and there's more stress, and you never get time and a break. Because if you think about the stress response, you respond to the situation and you're supposed to get time to recover. The best example I can think of kind of the physiological stress response is, I'm sure everybody's been kind of a near-miss accident in your car. There's that moment where you notice something's going on and you can kind of feel yourself tense up. If you really paid attention, your heart's beating faster and your eyes are dilated. You're kind of ready to do something. You step on the brakes and then you sit back in the car and you go, right? It's kind of that moment where you just kind of like drop down below baseline and get a chance to just kind of recover and come back. When we're having stress all the time, we don't get those opportunities to rejuvenate and to bounce back. And then the how you deal with it. And that's really where the cognitive behavioral aspects come in. How is it we deal with stress in terms of adaptive coping strategies, how we think about things, and how we appraise them? So what's damaging to health is unrelieved stress. It's a stress that doesn't go away or that we're not coping with very well, and so it persists. So how much stress is just right? I have no clue. Anybody know an answer? I never quite get the balance right. Seems like there's too much or too little. And that is that too much or too little decreases performance. They've done studies with college students where they gave them exams and they told one group of students that it didn't matter. We don't care how you do. You know, we're just doing this test and we'll have some data, but it's not going to impact you. They told another group that how you do on this test is going to impact the rest of your college career. If you don't do well on this, you know, you're probably not going to make it. And they told the middle group that it was going to give us some good information to help you and place you correctly, but it wasn't a do-or-die thing. And it was the last group that did the best. The other two groups did equally badly. I don't care. Or I'm so stressed that I can't think clearly and I can't concentrate. Wow. So it is kind of hitting that balance for us. So, Hans Selye is the physician who identified and documented the fight or flight response or the generalized adaptation syndrome. And he said that complete freedom from stress is death. I have a rule when I do therapy that we shouldn't set goals for ourselves that only dead people can achieve. And I think we do that a lot. You know, I shouldn't be upset about this. You know, this should be easy. When in reality, there are a lot of situations where we are going to be upset and we are going to be stressed. So when I worked at the VA, I'd frequently see people before they had open heart surgeries or, you know, pretty serious surgeries, and frequently they'd look at me and they'd go, I'm really nervous. So it's the people that aren't nervous I'm worried about. Because it's a scary thing. Okay, so thinking and stress, and that's the cognitive behavioral piece. Stressors only produce stress when the individual perceives the event as stressful. That make perfect sense? So how we evaluate situations and how we think about them is going to determine just what is that level of distress that we're experiencing in the situation. The best example of that I can think of is if we were all hiking down a trail in the Wasatch and a large snake slithered out across the path. Any of you would be running for the hills? No? People be standing there kind of hanging out with the snake?
No?
Yeah.
Walk away slow.
What? Walk away slow. Okay. How you react to that situation is not about the snake. It's not like the snake's going to look up at some people and go hi and look up at other people and make ugly faces or something. It's going to be determined by maybe how much you know about snakes. You know, look down and go, yeah, it's just a gopher snake. It's not dangerous. Or it might be dangerous, but if I walk away slow, I'll be okay. Or it might be that I'm thinking, you know, maybe there are cobras in Utah. He's going to bite me and I'm going to die and my life is going to be over. And if I don't make it down the hill, you know. So it's what we tell ourselves as opposed to the situation per se that creates the distress and the experience that we have. So just thinking about a stressful situation can trigger the stress response. That makes sense? Had that experience where you're kind of sitting there thinking about something at work coming up or some conversation you need to have with somebody that's difficult, you might as well be there doing it, because your body's reacting as if you're doing it. So our greater thinking capacity makes stress a complex problem. It's much easier for my cats. You know, they kind of move on more quickly. They let go of things. They don't remember things very much. So it is that kind of thinking and being able to think about things that makes stress a much more complicated thing for us. This is an old concept, and I kind of like this quote. And some year I'll figure out what play it's in, but William Shakespeare in one of his plays said that thinking makes it so. So I think for a long time people have had some awareness that it's how we think about things that impacts how we experience them. So what's cognitive behavioral therapy? Cognitive behavioral therapy is kind of the process of taking a look at how we're thinking, learning how to reevaluate that, and shift it to something else so that we're feeling differently in the same situation. Does it sound easy? Frequently people think it sounds kind of easy until you try to implement it. It's actually kind of a, you know, my two watchwords in therapy are that it's about balance and finding a middle place, and it's a process of change over time, and I'm going to be really good when I'm 100. Because it's something that you just kind of keep working at. So if you think about what we're talking about, there's some kind of an event, something that's going on that we're thinking about. I have to come to offer to give a talk tonight. Okay? So my thinking about that is, oh my God, there are going to be terrible and awful people there, and they're going to all know all of this stuff, and I'm not going to be able to tell them anything they don't know, and I'm going to make a real fool of myself and forget what I need to say, right? How do you imagine I might be feeling if I was thinking that on the way over here? Terrible. Yeah. So that would lead to probably feeling more anxious and being more tense and being more uncomfortable. So if I look at that and I dispute that belief or thinking, you know, I have a PhD, I might know a few things that they don't know. And the worst thing that'll happen is that I'll say something stupid or I'll forget what I wanted to say. And that's not the end of the world. It's not life-threatening. It's happened to me before. It'll happen again. Okay? So if I can change my thinking to that, it's going to change how I feel and behave. So I'm going to be able to come here and talk and not sound like a complete idiot, only every once in a while. No. So that's kind of the process that cognitive behavioral therapy takes a look at. So if you think about it, in any situation, we can do one of three things. And actually, Albert Ellis is a famous psychologist who said this. And I think there are actually four, but we'll do his three first. You can try and change the situation. You can get in there and kind of problem solve and work with the people that you're involved with to see if you can change what's going on. You can get out of the situation. You can just leave. That might change how you're feeling about it. And the last is change how you think about the situation. Of those three, I think the last one's the hardest. Because what you need to do is change how you think about the situation so that you can still be there without feeling as distressed. I think oftentimes it's much easier to walk away. Often changing things is a little bit more difficult, especially if we have to work with other people. But I do think it's hardest to change how we think about things so that we're not as distressed. The other thing we can all do is nothing. Kind of vote you forgot that as an option. And oftentimes that's what we do. We worry about things and we think about things and we don't do anything about them. So what are irrational beliefs? Talk about beliefs that don't make any sense. And all of us have them. I certainly have my fair share of them. And I think it's important for us to see what are the beliefs that we have about the world or how we should be or how people should interact that have a negative impact on how we function. And so some of these are things like, it's absolutely necessary for me to have love and approval from peers, family, and friends. Everybody has to like me. And I'll do anything I can to make that happen. I think that's a pretty common one. And it's pretty impossible. I must be unfailingly competent and almost perfect in everything I do. Because if I work really hard, I can be perfect. Somebody said, that's me. No. Yeah. Deal a lot with, you know, all we have to do is do our best, and people always look at me and think, but how do you know that you did your best? There has to be some way to measure that. And the truth is, your best is different every day, right? You guys all know that. My chronic illnesses, chronic fatigue, and pain problems. I was using the example that when I went up skiing last year, the first day I went out, I couldn't make my skis work for love nor money. I kept stopping, trying to do something in a different way, and I was so frustrated. Well, the next time I skied, it was at a ski lesson at Snowbird, and they took me off the tram and said, ski. And I went, oh yeah, sure. And I did fine. I wasn't trying, you know, the first day was my best. Didn't look very good, but it was the best that I could do at that moment for variables that I'll never understand. So her question is there a reason for people to want to be perfect? I have no idea. A lot of people have the same beliefs, and I think part of it is, you know, that maybe there's a biological piece to wanting to do well and wanting to do things. I think there are huge cultural and societal things, you know, that everybody's working harder to do more. You know, some of it comes from our childhood and what our parents told us. So I think there are a lot of different variables that play into that. Yeah, I do think there are connections between them, and you know, usually we have little bits and pieces of all of them that impact how it is that we feel. But if I'm feeling like I have to be confident, I probably wouldn't have come tonight. I actually worked at a place where at Christmas, at the Christmas party, they used to hand out the Boner of the Year award. It was a large dog biscuit with a bow wrapped around it. And people would spend all year watching for silly and stupid things that people did. And you'd sit at the Christmas party going, no, it can't be my turn. You know, my friends got awards for evaluating dead people in rehab unit. I got an award for tucking my skirt into my pantyhose. You know, I mean, I think sometimes we need to remember that part of our job is to give people something to talk about and to be a little comic relief. So, certain people are evil, wicked, and villainous and should be punished. It's kind of that sense that things should be right. And, you know, there should be a punishment for people that do things that are bad. My world doesn't work out that way very often. Another one, it's horrible when things are not the way I would like them to be. Isn't it? Horrible, terrible, awful. Should be the way I want them to be. People should behave the way I want them to behave. Yeah. I used to do that with my sister, who will be late for her own funeral. It worked really well. I just wound up being upset, and finally one day I went, is there something wrong with me that I'm expecting her to be on time? There must be something wrong with me because it's not about her. Yeah. So, external events cause most of my misery. I simply react to events that trigger my emotions. I hear that all the time. So and so made me feel that way. You know, somebody else's fault that happened to me. I certainly had no control over that. Or it's because of this, and that happened in my childhood that I'm this way. Kind of victim thing or helplessness. I try not to be there, but every once in a while. I should be fearful or anxious about anything that's unknown, uncertain, or potentially dangerous. I have a client who's really anxious, and he told me one day that if he didn't worry about it, something bad would happen. I said, really? I don't think so. You use up a lot of energy being worried and anxious about things and anticipation. And what happens at the other end? It's like, well, that wasn't quite so bad. Even things that we know aren't going to be as serious. It's easier to avoid than face life's difficulties and responsibilities. I could be an ostrich. Yeah, we are a culture of conflict avoiders. Anybody here? No. I hear that all the time. You know, I do anything to please people. I have a client right now who's really unfortunate in that respect. She's always done that. Always, always, always. She never takes care of herself. And you know the big group that I see is women in their 40s or 50s, and they look at me and they go, but I used to be able to do it all. And all of a sudden they have a chronic illness, and they're getting older, and you don't have as much energy, and they're stuck with, you know, but I used to take care of everything for everybody else, and I never took any time to take care of myself, and what are you asking me to do? So I think that's a common theme. And I need something other than me or stronger or greater than me to rely on. I can't take care of myself. So I'm sure that there are lots of other ones. The past has a lot to do with determining the present, that notion that, you know, we're kind of stuck where we are. And I think happiness can be achieved by inaction, passivity, and endless leisure. I met a guy once who's a psychologist who said that he had no clue how people really felt, and so he was keeping a diary every day. And so every day he wrote down what his mood was because he didn't know how people's moods were supposed to be. It's a little eccentric. But I hear that a lot. People have this notion that someday they're going to be happy. We're going to live happily ever after, and life will be wonderful. Mine hasn't worked out that way. I think the media and a lot of the things that we see in our world kind of reinforce that, you know, some of that belief that, you know, if we persevere for a while, you know, Prince Charming will come and we'll run off into the sunset, or my favorite movie to pick on is Sleepless in Seattle. We'll meet at the top of the Empire State Building. It'll be wonderful. What they forgot was the next scene where they're arguing about who didn't take the trash out. So there are also patterns of limiting thinking that we do. Filtering. I'll listen to this stuff, but I won't listen to that stuff. You know, or I filter it through what my beliefs and my experience are rather than looking at other alternative explanations. Polarized thinking, black and white. It's either all or nothing. It's either good or it's really terrible and awful. That's a common one. I'm either really aggressive or I'm really passive. It's really easy to do all or nothing. It's a lot harder to be in the middle. You know, to find some balance in there. And that's why I always think about balance as being really important. The example I can think about with that is usually it's easier for people to quit smoking than to manage their diet. Because you still have to eat. It's not something you can just quit doing altogether. And I think it's why most of us do better on diets that are more restricted, because we don't have to think about that balance and figure out options. Overgeneralization. It's this way once, it's this way all the time. Right? We're little creatures that like to control things and be able to predict things. You know, it makes life easier if I know what's going to happen and if I know what it's going to be. And I think this is particularly a thing that gets people in trouble who have pain issues and chronic illness issues, because somehow I'm going to be able to figure out what the things are that I can do so that I'm not going to hurt as much, or I'm not going to feel as tired, or that something else isn't going to happen. And you know what? It doesn't work. I have some knee problems, and I've yet to figure it out, so I've just decided I have no clue. Because some days I can do things that I shouldn't be able to do, and I'm fine the next day. And there are days I wake up and my knees feel like I ran a marathon. And I think the more that we work on figuring that out, the more we wind up restricting or shifting our activities in ways that limit us. Migrating. How often do I hear that one? Well, I know what they're going to say. I know what they're thinking. Usually gets us in trouble, doesn't it?
I may not know what they're going to say, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be bad.
Okay, so I don't know what they're going to say, but it's going to be bad? Yeah. You know, sometimes that's true, but it's always good to check it out. We catch ourselves when we're doing that. Catastrophizing. It's going to be terrible and awful. The earth will end. Yeah. People with anxiety disorders are usually very good at this one. You always anticipate the worst. And I've heard it put that, you know, if I anticipate the worst, then nothing bad can happen. I'll be ready for everything. And what that gets us is using up a whole lot of energy for not much benefit. Had a client once that went camping with friends, and she had a horrible problem with generalized anxiety disorder. She came back and she said, "They're not going to take me camping again." And I said, "Why not?" She said, "Well, we were in the woods someplace where they had bears, and I spent the whole weekend haranguing people about bears. I told them all to talk more." I mean, she just spent the entire time worried about where the food was and what everybody was doing. Drove them absolutely crazy. probably didn't protect them more from bears, they just all wanted to go home. Magnifying, making things bigger than what they might be. Personalization, it must be about me. Right? If somebody's sleeping in the back row, it must be because I'm boring. It couldn't be because they didn't take a nap today. Yeah. I think it's one of the things, and it's one of the things I've been working on, is that in our need to control things, if it's about me, I can fix it. If it's not about me, then I have to figure out how to deal with it or have to accept what's going on. And so I think we have a tendency to take things very, very personally. We do that with our pets. You know, he chewed up that couch because he was mad at me. Couldn't be because he was a dog. Right? Yeah, that wouldn't be the reason. So I think it is that, you know, we make things be about us. And that's one of the ways, and one of the thinking cells that really gets us into trouble. I always say that things happen to me, but they're not about me. Because the other person always has the option to respond in a different way. And how people respond to me comes from their experience and what's going on for them. Doesn't let me off the hook. I still have to think about what I'm doing and try and treat people the way that I would like to be treated. But it doesn't guarantee the other side of it. So I do think that's one of those things that's helpful for people to think about and to work on changing. And it's a tough one. People say, well, but it happened to me. It must be about me. And shoulds. If you hear yourself saying should, be careful. Yeah. My rule, which actually probably can be a rule by my rule, is that there are only 10 rules. They were written in stone, I think. 10 commandments. You know, there aren't that many things that are absolutes. And so a lot of times we're feeling like we should act a certain way or we should do things. And usually when we're doing that, we're getting ourselves in trouble. So, if any of you are familiar with the book, The Four Agreements, it's kind of a nice little book, and if you want to pick something up to read that talks a little bit about cognitive behavioral thing, I think it's actually not a bad thing. He's a Mexican, kind of a spiritual guy, who believes that if you're told something, you will become that way. So if I believe what you tell me about me, it will become true. You know, as you're reading it, you can take with a grain of salt or not. But I think kind of underlying has that same principle that how we think determines how we feel and behave and influences what we're able to do. And he makes the argument that if we make four different agreements that we would be better. And one is not to make assumptions, that not migrating. So if you go back to the other things I was talking about, you know, checking things out with people, making sure that we know what's really going on. Another one is to be true to yourself. Think about what you need and how that works with what's going on with other people and not ignoring that. I saw a young man whose wife left him the other day and I said, well, what do you want out of your marriage? He goes, well, I don't know. I said, well, this is kind of a good opportunity to think about that and figure it out. You know, what is it that's important to you? What do you want to be different if she's to come back? You know, even if she left, this is an opportunity to do that. Don't take it personally. You know, we're not that important. I was like kind of tricking people in therapy. I'll be saying something and I'll go, oh, really important. You know, in some way it sounds pretty self-involved. And I know it's not what people are intending when they do it. But if you look at it that way, it is. Oh, I'm glad I got the fourth one. I never get all four. So I can do it on slides too. The fourth one actually is you only have to do your best, and that obviously was my best that day. And I think he really nicely makes the point that your best isn't always the same. And anybody who had kids who were sick all night know that your best isn't the same the next day when you don't get a good night's sleep. And certainly with chronic illnesses, that's true. So the other thing I've been really thinking a lot about is acceptance. Because I think what I see with a lot of people who have chronic illnesses is that we try to pretend like or work towards something that's different. So we resist what the situation is. Not sure I was that's right. And so part of it is accepting what the reality is and learning to work with it. I work with a young woman who had back pain, and she was always waiting for the day when she was going to not have pain. So life was on hold. So the day she didn't have pain, she did way too much. The next day she couldn't do anything, felt horrible. But she never got that pain just really wasn't going to go away, and she needed to find a way to make peace with that and to learn to work with it. So I think it's an important kind of different way to think about things. I saw a gentleman who has horrible insomnia, and he's very compulsive. And, you know, unfortunately, his physician gave him the code so he could change his own CPAP machine. And, you know, he came in, it's like, I've tried that, and that, and that, you know, if I do this, then, you know, it's like he's going to find the solution so that he never has trouble sleeping again. And I looked at him and I said, you know, maybe we ought to consider that this is always going to be a problem. And I almost had to pick him up off the floor. You know, it doesn't mean that we're not going to work at finding new solutions or strategies or things that are going to improve the situation, but that we're at least going to accept that this is something that we have to live with and adjust to and adapt to. So she's asking a question about how you find balance between taking responsibility and working towards improvement and accepting.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'll use myself as an example because I do have really crappy knees. And, you know, the plan is that the orthopedists always look at me and they say, well, and then we could do this, and then we could do that, and then we could do knee replacements. And I go, am I feeling better, man? I'm not thinking so. I can do things that are going to improve my ability to function. I can ride my stationary bike. I can do exercises. I can avoid some things that I know, you know, are going to be particularly bad for my knees. Those are going to improve the probability that I can do the things that I want to do. On the other hand, and you guys are all going to think I'm crazy, but I do ski because I really like it. And it's not the best thing for my knees, but you know, we all do things that we like even though they're not the best thing for us. And that's a decision we make, I think, need to own. And there, it's kind of knowing that I go up skiing and in my brain is a part of me that says, okay, this could be a good day and it could be a crappy day. And I always have a good book. And my friends are really used to me saying, you know, I can't ski that really difficult stuff today. I'm going to go over there and ski. They're also really used to me saying, you know, I've had it. I'm going to go in. Actually, we ski with another couple and she has knee problems too. So we actually take two cars. So the girls can head down the mountain when we've had enough. So the acceptance piece is, and I can't ski 8 hours a day, and I can't, you know, I need to pay attention to that and do it in a different way. So does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I think when people hear that, their first thought is, well, that just means that nothing's going to get better, that I have to give up. And I think there is a balance, and I think that balancing step is hard to do, and I don't always do it very well.
Mm-hmm. I think the blind acceptance and the acceptance, that's what I think a lot of us have problems with, is the blind acceptance, is just giving up, mm-hmm. but the acceptance is accepting limits and then working towards it, maybe.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, figuring out, and for me it's figuring out different ways to accomplish the same kinds of things. You know, there might be some things that I can't do, and it doesn't mean I can't have fun, and it doesn't mean I can't do some other things. I just need to do it in a different way and consider that. So I always have backup plans. And you know what? That's really hard, because I want to stay on the mountain with everybody else, and I want to be able to do the same stuff they're doing. It's taken me a long time to practice at that and to get better at it and to be willing to go down and not try and keep up and suffer the next day. So the importance of accepting reality as it is this moment, learning to practice acceptance is the first step to real and lasting change. And I think that's really true. It's easy to avoid, deny, or disagree with what's happening in one's life. For example, it's common to say things like, it shouldn't be happening, I can't stand this, one is guaranteed to lose an argument with reality every time. Acceptance of what is, even if one does not like it, helps generate solutions rather than remaining stuck in the problem. Acceptance of the path of the, acceptance is a path to change in the future. So that's that notion. I just find it kind of hard to explain.
I find that if I make a list of the things I need to do during the week, that I can accomplish them once in a while.
But for the most part, if I try to do everything in one day, it puts me in bed for 2 to 3 days. So by making a list, I can look at that list and I can do it as I can.
Yeah, so accepting that you might not and likely won't be able to do it all at one time allows you to get more things accomplished in a week than if you did too much in one day. And I think that's true. I know I hear that a lot from people I work with chronic fatigue. I hear that a lot with people with chronic pain. Pacing is so hard. Pacing activities. You don't want to do it all now. So there actually are some psychologists who are kind of looking at acceptance as a part of therapy, and it's kind of new, and I found some information, and they're saying that a lot of psychological suffering is caused by avoiding or attempts to avoid and escape or get rid of unwanted private sensations and feelings, as well as, you know, denying things that are true in our reality, and that that's an important thing to work on. So it's something that a lot more people are talking about. So it works in the short run, but it usually fails in the long run. And obviously shifting energy towards solving problems works a whole lot better. So, acceptance. It's related to those control issues I talked about. If I figure it out, I can control it, right? I'll never quit doing that to some extent. But I think kind of letting that, there was a lot of the people who are doing that are also kind of working on more Eastern kind of mindfulness and kind of being in the moment as opposed to, you know, worrying about where we're going in the future. Okay. Hopefulness is important. You know, a couple of people have asked questions about, you know, how do you do this and not just kind of give up? That's kind of being helpful about changes in the future. Every time I see my orthopedist, I tell him he best be working on new solutions. And at least if I need a knee replacement, I want one I can ski on. So I'm certainly hopeful that things are going to change and there are going to be new options in the future and that I can work on things. And that notion of action versus resistance. When we resist something, what happens? We A, use up a lot of energy. B, probably aren't getting very far, if not being pushed backwards. So I just think about it from a, you know, more like a physics aspect. That works. So, as you travel life's highway, don't forget to stop and eat the roses. Kind of like those guys. Cow philosophy. So, tips. The thing we've been talking about is having a conversation with yourself, and it really is okay to talk to yourself. And you can even answer yourself, as long as you don't think there's someone else in your brain talking to you. I think that's when you get in trouble. So changing how we talk to ourselves can be important. You can journal and write things down. Oftentimes, if there's a situation where you're feeling distressed, sit down afterwards and think about, what was I telling myself? What was it about that situation, you know, that led to the distress that was I was experiencing? Was I catastrophizing? Client of mine came in today and she told me that I think it's her 17-year-old son has decided that he doesn't like religion and you know doesn't think God exists. And she's very Catholic. And she's very distressed about this. And she said, well, you know, he just keeps doing that to me. And I said, I don't think this is about you. So her just sitting down and thinking about what it is. That's about him and what he's struggling with at the time. Yes?
He knows how to push your buttons.
Absolutely, he knows how to push your buttons was the comment. Right, yeah, we did talk about that. But I think, you know, how you think about things, writing that down, you know, talking with other people about it, and then seeing if you can create or change that, you know, thought to something different that creates less distress for you. And that, it's not related to thinking, but speaking up for yourself, I think most of us could, you know, work on being more assertive. And I think in order to be that and step up and speak up for ourselves, you know, working on some of those beliefs is important. And I just think this is really important for people with chronic illnesses. I saw an adolescent with diabetes and I said, you have any issues around diabetes? Oh, no, no. I've had it for a long time. I'm fine with it. And I said, gosh, gee, you know, people always tell me it's kind of hard to have to ask your friends to have lunch at a certain time or have to ask them to have special accommodations for them. Oh, no, that's not a problem with that. Well, she agreed to be much better at managing her diabetes. And when she came in 2 weeks, I said, well, how's it going? She goes, you know, it was really uncomfortable having to ask people to wait for me all the time. You know, I hear that a lot from people. And, you know, that is one of the things that's hard for me sometimes when I go skiing, you know, or go do things with other people, is that I need to have another plan involved in that. And it does impact the other people in my life. And, oh, well, you know what? They still like me anyway. And finding the humor. I just think humor and laughing is so important. Gilda Radner, I think there's some people who are old enough to remember her. I hate when I say that in therapy, people go, huh? I'm like, oh no. But Gilda Radner was a comedian on Saturday Night Live, and she died of ovarian cancer. And she wrote a book about her experiences. And one of the things she said in that book is that at one point she realized that she could no longer find the humor in her ovarian cancer. And that's what her life had been about, was finding the humor in the things that happened in her life. And she decided it was really important for her to be able to find the humor. And I think about that every once in a while because I think, if she could find humor in ovarian cancer, I should be able to find humor in what's happening in my life. So I think kind of finding ways to laugh at ourselves or laugh with other people. And, you know, there's nothing better than those mindless, silly movies. So, kind of reprioritizing, thinking about what's really important. Pretend today is your last day. Someone made me do that in a class on death and dying. You know, we had to imagine that somebody had just told us that we only had a short time to live. None of us talked about wanting to go to work. You've got 3 months to live. I'm going to work really hard. You know, so sometimes we kind of get off kilter and wind up spending time and energy doing things that aren't really as important to us. And this is my humor for the day. This is a blue-footed booby. It's a real bird. We went to the Galapagos this summer. I mean, this always kind of makes me smile. I was listening to a person on National Public Radio the other day, and they were talking about that what's more important than big events in our lives are little things during the day that give us joy. And it's a woman who does interviews on NPR that kind of has a strange voice. I never know her name. Bad at names. But she mentioned that she had this dog, and you know how when the dog ran down the sidewalk to see her, that it just made her smile. And I think there are those little things in life that we need to pay attention to that are much more important than the big, huge events that we usually tie things to. So, if anyone has questions,
we're all very domesticated in our thinking. We really do become in one way or another a copy of our environment and our family, and that we owe it to ourselves to recognize that we're domesticated in our thinking and decide whether we want to accept who we've been created as, or do we want to create something different.
Okay. Yeah. I don't remember exactly how I put it. And I think there's a lot of truth in what he says. You know, the things that we were told. I was like, when I was growing up, my sister was the cute one and I was the smart one. I finally figured it out. She's smart and I'm cute, you know? It's like, but for many years, you know, if you talk to my sister, oh, she wasn't smart. I went back and looked at our high school, you know, our high school grades. They were about the same. But we were told that, and I think, you know, it took her a long time to finally get to school and to get a career because she kept telling herself she wasn't smart because that's what other people told her. It's a good example.
I have a question. I was wondering, I struggle with that idea of acceptance because I don't want to give up completely on the idea that, for example, maybe this illness that just came suddenly couldn't, maybe someday, it's unlikely that it might just go away. I want to believe that. even though I know it's not that probable. I'm wondering if perhaps instead of thinking of acceptance, I could think of recognition of reality instead of accepting reality. Would there be a problem with that as far as you can see?
I think it's a little semantic that I'm trying to think of a nice way to say this. That you know, acceptance is of what is right now. And if you think about it in that more kind of Eastern way, that I don't have to accept that I'm not going to be able to do those things forever. I just have to accept that right now this is where I am and this is what's happening to me. And I always think about Christopher Reeves. Because he always talked about that he was going to walk. Okay, but his life was acceptance of his situation. You know, he continued to do things. He worked within the limitations that he had, and was very productive. And so when I think about, you know, not accepting it and how, you know, wanting this other thing to happen and for it to magically go away, you know, I think about when I did work. I worked with a rehab unit with people with spinal cord injuries. And I really didn't care if people thought they would walk again as long as they were learning how to transfer and function and be able to live until that moment happened. Does that make sense? What?
Or
it didn't happen. Right.
We've talked about changing.
Mm-hmm.
And so on. But how long should we expect that change to take?
Forever. That's my standing joke, is that I'll be really good at this when I'm 100. That it's a constant process of change. How I think about the process of change is that to begin with, what we do is we find ourselves upset and anxious or whatever, and we have to stop and say, well, what did I do? As we work on that, we get to where we can move that point of recognition closer to the beginning, and then actually maybe to anticipate events where we might need to do things in a different way or watch, you know, kind of high stress or high risk situations. But, you know, I'm real good at who my dad is, and he can still nail me. You know.
I'm anxious about some of the things next week that I'm anxious about this week.
No. Mm-hmm. No. And I think that's that being nice to ourselves. It is a process of change. And that's one of the things I hear a lot, you know. Well, but I'm not better yet. I'm not perfect at it. Back to that perfect thing.
There's a quote by Mark Twain that has really helped me a lot. And he says, as I reached the end of my life, I realized that all of the things that I had intensely worried about never happened.
Absolutely. That's a great quote. That's absolutely a great quote.
I have been really sick for only about 12 weeks. And at first I was crying every single day and throwing a fit and having a meltdown. And now I'm only having a meltdown about every 3 weeks. And to me, that's progress.
Absolutely.
You know, I threw my shoe at the wall one day and it ricocheted off the window and luckily didn't break it. But I left the mark of the shoe on the wall to remind myself it's okay to have a meltdown and then move on. And they're quicker and they're less frequent. So that's progress.
Absolutely. And, you know, it kind of makes me think of that notion that, you know, being kind to ourselves and not setting goals that only dead people can achieve. I'm much better at accepting my need stuff, but that doesn't mean I'm happy about it.
I just wanted to say that I can remember the exact moment of the exact day when I realized that I had misdefined the word acceptance, and I had defined it as resignation. And when I cleared that up, it made all the difference in the world for me.
I don't have this question totally formulated, but I'm wondering if you can comment on the challenges we have in speaking and asking for what we want, considering the stigma surrounding undefined, unknown chronic illnesses.
Ah,
good question. So I run up against that one all the time.
Right, yeah. And I think you still do it in the same way. And I think what happens, you know, if it's, you know, healthcare providers or work things or whatever, is that you wind up working through that. You know, either finding new healthcare providers because what you need and want isn't something that they can give you, which is not about you. it's about now. But I think what winds up happening is we ask for what we need and want, and when we don't get it, we realize that we need to change something. And so it can be changing, you know, the situation. I think sometimes that's why we don't want to ask for things, because what if someone says no?
Then we're left with the...
Right. And, you know, in some situations we can choose, you know. If I go to a healthcare provider, actually, the woman with post polio is really struggling with it. A lot of, you know, people in Utah that don't know much about that. And, you know, when she asks for what she needs and wants, they're pretty resistant. And I've really encouraged her to find a new provider.
How long do you think it's going to take for attitudes to change around this to make it easier for patients to...
Ooh.
I don't know.
You know, it'd be the same thing with depression or, you know, psychiatric things. I don't know, when we find the test for it, you know, and there's something absolutely, you know, definable, you know, when it's like, you know, having a high white blood count when you have an infection or something. I think, you know, when the more tangible things become for people, the easier it is for them to see that as something real. As long as it's something that's kind of the diagnosis of exclusion or one, you know, where... I was watching a TV show and they were talking about depression, and somebody said, well, you know, did you just ask them how they felt? Did you have some way to, you know, define that, to make it real? And I think the same thing happens with, you know, people with depression, anxiety, and a number of illnesses. So I hope it changes quickly, but...
Thank you.
Any other questions?